find anything, so they might throw a few pills at you, but you go home and still have the same problems. And I know about that because I frankly lived like that for a lot of my life. Thankfully, I've learned some things that have really helped me, and I'm still learning all the time, and I just felt that I wanted to share this word with you today. So first of all, we want to look at 1 Corinthians 6, 19 and 20. Do you not know that your body is the temple, the very sanctuary of the Holy Spirit who lives within you? Everybody in here today say, I am the home of God.
I am the home of God.
Wow. You are God's house as a born-again believer, whom you have received as a gift from God. You are not your own. Wow, we need that revelation, don't we? You were bought with a price, purchased with a preciousness, and paid for and made His own. So then honor God and bring glory to Him in your body. Now, what does it mean that you were paid for? We were bought and paid for with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. He purchased us back from the enemy who before our relationship with Christ was in charge in our life through lies and deceptions. He was ruling us through lies and deceptions. But now we have the Spirit of God, we have the truth of God's Word, and little by little, day after day, we are entering into more and more freedom and being able to enjoy the kind of life that God intended for people to have in the beginning of time. Your body is the very sanctuary of God. Let's just suppose that you were looking for a church to go to. You've become a believer and now you're looking for a church to go to. Well, if you saw one on this certain street, but man, the paint was all peeling off and it just, boards were loose and it was all broken down and it just didn't look good at all, that probably wouldn't be the one that you would choose, because the way that church looked would already say a lot to you about the leadership and what probably was or was not going on inside. And so, like it or not, how things look do affect us. It's just the way it is. So today, if we are the house of God and people are looking at us, I think that we should make the best representation that we possibly can. Now, when I say this, I'm not talking about body size or hairstyle or, you know, any of those kinds of things. I'm just talking about valuing yourself enough to take what you have and do the very best that you can with it. How are we going to impress anybody else if we're just dragging ourselves around all the time with a sour look on our face? Well, how are you? Well, I'm just pressing through, I tell you. It's just tough. I mean, I'm under this and under that. I mean, we have problems. Our problems are real, and we need to be able to express those. But I think as our representation to the world, as the body of believers, and our representation to the world of, hey, this is what it's like to be a Christian, then we should be happy, have a smile on our face, have some victory, be doing good things for people. We should be making a very positive impact and influence in the world today. And I think it's fairly safe to say that if we, as an entire body of believers, and when I say we, I'm certainly talking about more than those of us in this room or even those who might be watching the program today. I'm talking about believers worldwide. If we were behaving the way we should and doing things the way we should, I would pretty much say that we would be such a billboard for relationship with Christ that we would not be dealing with all the people that are deceived and lost in the world that we are today. So, I think it's time that we step up to the plate and each of us do a little bit better in how we take care of ourselves. Is everybody still okay? You're still breathing, right? We're all right. All right. And don't you turn your television off. That is not fair. You haven't even heard the rest of what I'm going to say. You need to hear this. 2 Corinthians 5:20. So we are Christ's ambassadors, God making His appeal, as it were, through us. Don't you love this? And I love now what the Amplified says. We are Christ's personal representatives. Wow. Penny Shepherd, personal representative of Jesus Christ. My, my, my. Just think about that. Joyce Meyer, personal representative of Jesus Christ. You're a personal representative. I'm here to represent Jesus Christ. Amen. I beg you, Paul said, I beg you for his sake to lay hold of the divine favor now offered to you and be reconciled to God. Now, I think a lot of times some of the things that I'm going to talk about today, people think, oh, God don't care about that. I mean, you know, with all the, because really the five or six points I want to bring you today are just so simple. It's like, well, duh, how did I miss that? But, you know, sometimes we can just complicate things so bad that we just miss the simple things that we could do that would really make a big difference. And so he does care about all the little things. And it's not, God doesn't want us to just go to church on Sunday. He wants us to live the life that's going to represent him all week long. So Romans 12:1 in the Message Bible is very interesting. I almost always use the Amplified Translation, but this is so cool. Listen to this. So here's what I want you to do, God helping you. Take your everyday, ordinary life, your sleeping, eating, going to work, and walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. Wow. Let me do this again. Your sleeping, eating, going to work, and walking around life, and let us place that before God as an offering. Embracing what God does for you is the best thing you can do for him. Don't become so well-adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Wow. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out, readily recognizing what he wants from you and quickly responding to it. Unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to its level of immaturity, God brings the best out of you and develops well-formed maturity in you. Okay, so let's talk for a little bit about how important it is for you to take care of yourself. First of all, if you don't take care of yourself, I don't know who you think's going to. And you only have one chance here. You only have one body. And if you wear it out early, you can't go somewhere and buy another one. Now, you know, today they're so good at things that you can't even get replacement parts, but there are some things that you can't replace. Amen? And so you are important to God, and that's what I want to say to you. You're not here just, you're not an accident. You're not just here taking up space. God has something for you to do, something that is important, and you're not likely to do it, and neither am I if I feel bad all the time. God wants, I'm telling you, if I feel bad, I don't even want to pray. I'm sorry, maybe that doesn't sound very spiritual, but I mean, if I feel really bad, I don't want to study, I don't want to pray, I just want to do nothing. And that's not the way God wants us to be. He wants us to be energetic and full of zeal and able to do things and being creative in our thinking. And I'm certainly not implying here that we never have a tired day or an off day, but I'm talking about as a whole. When people say to you, how are you? You should be able to say truthfully, I'm great. Well, how have you been feeling? I'm doing really, really good. You know, I said to my daughter last week, I said, I have been feeling so good. And it felt so good to say that, because so many times when people ask you how you feel, there's always 15 areas that hurt, that bother us, that we can complain about. Now, I think that there are things that we need to do if we want to feel better. And a lot of them are things that you may think are insignificant, but I want to talk to you first about eating. We'll just get that one out of the way. First of all, no two people are going to look exactly alike in body size. So we don't need to, you know, get the world's view of what we should look like, but we need to just do the best we can. I've prayed for years, God, help me eat right, look good, feel good, and weigh what you want me to weigh. Not what I want to weigh, but what's right for my body. Because honestly, and we all know this, I mean, I have a friend that could just, she can eat four times what I do and she weighs 93 pounds. And it is a bit annoying sometimes, you know, when people can just eat the whole refrigerator and they never gain any weight. But we have to deal with what we've been given, see? And so my body's not like that. I've always had to be a little bit careful all my life, but I've come to the conclusion that instead of complaining about it, it's worth it to me to do it, because you know what most complaining is? It's just an excuse to not do what's right. Thank you for the great response. I've got you guys in here to cheer up the audience. Amen. Now, let me ask you a question. This thought came to me, and I thought, you know, that really is interesting. Why is it that if we decide to eat right, that we say we're on a diet? It's a lifestyle. Eating right, taking care of yourself, getting enough sleep, drinking water, having a balanced life, it's a lifestyle. It's not like, oh, discipline, gosh, self-control, hate it all. Let's think about mindless eating for a minute. You say, what's mindless eating? Well, it's all the stuff that people pick up and stick in their mouth that they don't even know they ate. I was in a furniture store one day. Who would expect to find cookies in a furniture store? I mean, I wouldn't think that there would be cookies in a furniture store. I have a shoe store that I go to. They always have chocolate chip cookies there. And if you don't eat them there, they want to bag them up and send them home with you. It's like, I came here for shoes, not cookies. I came for furniture, not cookies. Well, I noticed in the furniture store that when I went in, this plate was full. And when I left, it was totally empty. So that means that most people who walked by that plate of cookies picked one up, popped it in their mouth, and ate it. And they didn't even realize that they did it. And can I tell you something? Things that you don't even realize you're eating, you don't even enjoy them. And so half the time it leaves you still hungry or wanting something else. That's why some people say don't ever eat standing on your feet. Always sit down and eat and enjoy it. There's nothing wrong with eating something sweet, but there is definitely something wrong with overdoing anything. And I think at least if we're going to eat, we need to know we ate it. We need to have enjoyed it. And we need to not pick up everything that's laying around, eat it, and then say, well, I just don't know why I weigh too much. I just hardly ever eat a thing. And I used to have a fork problem, and I never would get dessert, but I would fork everybody else's to death. In other words, you know, I would not get any, but I would want three bites of Dave's. So by the time I had three bites of this and four bites of that and two bites of something else and a piece of this and a piece of that, I ate more than the people who just sat down and had dessert and admitted that they ate dessert. But we like to lie to ourselves and think that we're not doing something when, in fact, we are. So mindless eating, excessive eating, not eating enough. Some people don't eat enough. Unbalanced eating, bad eating, junk, sugar, drive-through, fast food, soda or pop, depending on what part of the country that you're from. In the South, if you say soda, they're like, huh? Lots of caffeine, fast food, prepackaged foods, excessive salt in food. Now, here's the thing. Get educated. You know, when I was growing up, I knew nothing about what I was eating, and I was always a chunky teenager, and it always caused me a lot of grief. I was usually the last girl to get asked to go to the dance, or probably never got asked to go to the dance in many cases, and I just was always, you know, I just didn't feel good about myself. I was fluffy. I wasn't, like, huge, but I was fluffy. And fluffy's comfortable if you're going to lay down on it and rest, but that's about all. But I think that's a nice way of saying that I'm overweight. I'm not overweight, I'm fluffy. And so here I'm, this overweight teenager, and it's making me miserable all the time. But I knew nothing about what to eat. My parents were from the country, and so everything was fried. Vegetables were kind of like a no-no. We had fried chicken, fried eggs, biscuits, gravy, fried pork, fried pies. I mean, we fried everything. And when I would come home from work, I mean, from school, my dad worked nights, and so a lot of evenings, what I would eat for dinner, my mother would take a box of Cremette macaroni, a whole little box, boil it, put a can of tomatoes in it, cut up an onion in it, And that would be my dinner. And then my dessert would usually be a piece of cake with a bunch of icing on it about that thick. And I didn't understand why I was overweight. I wasn't getting any protein, wasn't getting anything that was good for me. You know, people would even be smarter if they ate right. Well, they weren't trying to be bad parents. They just didn't know. We didn't know anything. And I went through a lot of bad health issues until I read my first book, simple book, on health and nutrition. And I was astounded when I began to realize what I was putting in my body that I had no idea that I was putting in my body. Now, most people would think it's not too exciting to spend your time reading a health book, but if you want to feel better, that's a great place to start. For example, there's a popular cheesecake that I loved. And I can tell you, when I went anywhere near it, I had bites. Not pieces. My old problem would resurrect and I would have bites. Until one day I decided to look up and see what was in it. The smallest amount of calories that any had in it was 850 for a piece, and the largest was 1,200. I have not eaten a piece since. You know why? Here's the reason. It's not worth it to me. See, it's just, some things are just not worth it if you know what you're doing. Another thing, we travel a lot, we're in hotels, and I don't know why, but you go off to the meeting, you come home, and they've decorated your pillow with chocolate candy. It's like this thing in hotels. Let us put you to sleep with chocolate and sugar. Well, like most people, I'd take one, looks good, pop it in my mouth, mindless eating. Until one day I decided to read the little paper on the back. Every one of those little pop-ins was 100 calories and all sugar. I don't pop them in anymore. I leave them, I throw them away, or I give them to somebody else that doesn't want to feel good, but I don't. I don't eat them. So, aren't we having fun? Aren't you glad you turned the program on today? Aren't we having fun? I'm sure you're thinking, I don't know why I'm sitting here watching this. Well, maybe you're just the one that needs it. So, get educated. Read labels. Sleep. 7 to 8 hours of sleep a night. Now, there are a few rare people who only need 4 or 5 hours sleep a night. But I'll tell you the truth, if you really only need that much sleep, then you should feel really good and energetic when you wake up. Sometimes when you're younger, you can do with 6 hours sleep, but I'm telling you what, by the time you get my age, you need to go to bed at night, and you need to get up in the morning. I'm much better in the morning. I get up 4:30, 5 o'clock, 5:30. I'm asleep at night by 8:30, 9 o'clock. I know to a lot of you that sounds insane, but you just wait till you get a little bit older. You're going to stop feeling like you have to be in on everything that's going on at night, everywhere it's going on, and you're going to say, no, I think I'm just going to stay home and get some rest. Now, things change as you get older. I'm not telling you you got to be in bed every night at 8:30 and up every morning at 4:30, but I think it's good to have a regular bedtime. Your body functions better if you have some kind of a regular bedtime, and you should get 7 to 8 hours sleep a night. So there you have it. Water. Drink half your body weight in water. Now, surely somebody's thinking, if I do that, I'll drown. Well, here's the thing. Drink at least 8 8-ounce glasses of water. And it's still a challenge for me, and I love water. But the only way that you're ever going to do it is to keep it with you all the time. Drink a lot of it in the morning, and that helps you, get you started off right. Everything we drink doesn't have to have some other flavor in it or some sugar in it or some caffeine in it. A lot of people say, well, I can't stand water. I just don't like water. You know, some people say water gagged them. I have a granddaughter that said, can't drink water. Well, my dad was like that, and he died with kidney disease. So water is the only thing that will properly cleanse your kidneys. So drink water. Doesn't mean you can't drink anything else, but drink lots of good, fresh, clean water. Here's the one you're going to hate. Exercise. Okay, let me just tell you quick. God gave us all these joints because we're supposed to move. That's the bottom line. And the more you move, the more you're going to be able to move. The more you do, the more you'll be able to do. The less you do, the less you are going to be able to do. That's a long story and longer than I have time to get into, but a few years back, God spoke to my heart one day very clearly, and he said, if you don't Start taking better care of yourself, including regular exercise. You are not going to be strong for the last one-third of your journey. Well, more than anything, it's important to me that I finish the call of God on my life. And I've already lived two-thirds of my life. Now, some of you, that doesn't mean anything to you, but to me, it means that I'm on the back end here. And I've got a lot left to do, and I want to do it, and I want to feel good. So I have to make an investment on the front end if I'm going to do that. And I can just tell you for me, and I know that a lot of people, exercise is like the biggest, but it has been the single best thing that I have ever done for myself, ever. To exercise on a regular basis, and now I've added walking, and you know, it doesn't cost you anything to walk. If you can't do anything else, get out and walk. I don't have time to walk. Can I just tell you this, and then we won't have to have any more arguments about it? People do what they want to do. I mean, it's just that simple. And I was the one, nobody was a bigger excuse maker than I was. I don't have time, I'm too busy, and you know, every time I try to exercise, I hurt myself. Well, that was because I tried to get in shape in two sessions, you know, and you can't do that. It's a commitment and an investment. And there's lots of different ways that you can do this. You can do it at home, you don't have to pay money to do it. You can walk, you can even be involved in a very active sport that you really enjoy. But I'm just saying, move. Everybody has to get some exercise or you are not going to feel good. Get plenty of rest. Eliminate as much stress as you can from your life. That's a big one, isn't it? Wow. You say, well, I can't help it. I'm just so stressed out. Well, you know what would change a lot of that? No, I can't do that. No, I don't think I better commit to that. No, I really need to stay home tonight and rest. No, little Johnny, you don't have to play five sports at school, so I live in the car chauffeuring you around. Pick one or two things that you would like to do. No is a word that will save your life. Amen. And let me just throw in here that anytime people want to hear yes, they're not going to like it if you say no. But you are responsible for yourself. Amen. And then along with this, laugh as much as you possibly can laugh. My goodness. Learn how to laugh at yourself. Amen. Amen. Go stand in a store and read funny birthday cards. I do that. They're hilarious. Some of them are just hilarious. Have a funny friend. I have a couple of funny friends. Mike Shepherd is one of my funny friends. He just makes me laugh. Laugh a little bit more at yourself. So just in closing, let me say that you need to seek to live a balanced life. And you know, whatever this meant to you today, it had to be fast. I said probably too much in too little time, but whether it's water or sleep or eating better or a little more exercise or getting more rest or laughing more, do some things for yourself because you are valuable and we want you to be around for a long, long time. And today I'm offering you my book called Look Great, Feel Great. Right there it is. 12 keys to enjoying a healthy life now.
Before break my heart. No, you can't be fair, you just don't know what I mean. This time's a monkey green. Come on and clear the vent now. Come on and move it, dance on down. We're gonna dance all of it, 'cause we're gonna party till the party and the party bumps. Dance with me, baby, and jump into my car.
Thank you.
Some of the things that you need to learn are in this book. We're offering this today for your gift to the ministry of $20 or more, and all of the money that you send in today is going to go to help just pay for television airtime. That's something I'd like you to be doing on a regular basis anyway, because we need your help. We want to continue to bring you these programs, but we also want to reach out to other people. So this is a good way for you to get some good help for yourself, or maybe you know somebody that you'd like to get this far that you think will be blessed by it. So take better care of yourself. You're valuable. Have a great day. I love you. Now, I can't resist going to John chapter 5. I haven't got to preach on this guy for about 6 months, and I just can't resist. It's my favorite story in the Bible, at least in this area of people being passive. John chapter 5, I'll just tell you a little bit of the story, and then we'll go to the verse I want to look at. They had a situation back then where when somebody was sick or crippled or diseased, there was one pool of water called the Pool of Bethesda that had some kind of a special God-type miraculous anointing on it. And one time a year, once a year only, an angel would come and stir up the waters, and these sick people lay around this pool all year waiting for the bubbling up of the water, and whoever fell into the water first received a healing. So now Jesus comes there and he sees a man who's been laying there, now listen to me, laying there 38 years. Now, he was crippled, we're going to give him that. But I'm going to tell you what, 38 years is a long time to lay somewhere. And Jesus came to him and he said, how long have you been there? I think he did it to shock the guy. So, how long have you been in the same mess? How long have you been murmuring about the same thing? I'll talk to you. You seem to be. I love you. I just want to help you. And I've had to go through all this. I told you the things that God says to me. You're not happy because you're selfish. Well, thanks. There was no they left with that. It was me. Well, they're selfish too. I'm not talking to them. I'm talking to you, Joyce. Every time God gets really strong with us, we want to tell him what's wrong with everybody else. And I'm not going to stand before God and give an account for somebody else's life. I'm only going to give an account for mine. And that's one thing we really have to learn is you do what's right and don't worry about what everybody else is doing. If you don't know one other human being that you think is doing what's right, you keep doing what's right. So he said to him, how long have you been in this condition? He already knew because he knows everything. But he did it to shock the man. 38 years. And then he said to him, do you really want to get well? Oh, what a question. What a question. Verse 6, let's put up John 5, verse 6. When Jesus noticed him lying there helpless, knowing that he had already been a long time in that condition, he said, do you really want to get well? Are you really in earnest about getting well? And I can tell you some people don't want to get well because then they would lose their reason to murmur. Whew, I'm preaching good today. Somebody's thinking, yes, sir, Sister Meyer, I know somebody just like that. And the invalid said, I just almost lose it every time I read this. It's the whole attitude that I'm talking about here today. And the invalid said, sir, I have nobody when the water's moving to put me into the pool. He's like, well, that makes sense. He was crippled. But while I'm trying to get there, somebody else always gets ahead of me. Now look, let me just show you something. 38 years laying by the, we're gonna say this is the pool, okay? 38 years I'm laying there. That's a lot of time. Okay, I get it, I'm crippled, but the rest of me works. Surely in 38 years, I think if he would have had any gumption about him, any determination, in 38 years, I think that I could... All right. Now, the next year when that angel comes, I'm gonna fall in. Because I'm so on the edge of this breakthrough. Amen?
Amen.
I ought to try preaching down here. This is pretty comfortable too. I told some people a few weeks ago when my back was bad, I said, you know what, I figured out my gift is in my mouth, so I could really do this laying down if I had to. So, Jesus looked at this guy and he said, get up! That's what he said to him. He didn't say, oh, you poor man, everybody else always gets ahead of you and you have nobody to put you in the pool. My gosh, I feel so bad for you. He said, get up! And then he said, and make up your bed. Take it with you. Some of you not only need to get up, you need to spend some time cleaning up the messes you've made all these years. Woo! Whoops. Hey, whatever it takes, if I got to crawl on the floor to get you guys to realize what I'm talking about. Don't have that attitude. Somebody else do it for me. You start asking God what you can do. Wilderness mentality number three. We are making radical progress. And I can't stand this attitude. Please make everything easy. I just can't take it if things are too hard. That wimpy, pitiful, pathetic, I can't. I just can't. It's just too hard. I can't. It's too much. I know I should forgive, but it's just hard. I know I should get out of debt, but my gosh, I'm going to have to go 3 years without putting anything on my credit card, and I just don't think I could be happy. Woo! You're anointed for hard things. You have the power of the Holy Spirit to help you do hard things. We don't need the power of God if we're going to just go around and do everything easy. This is too hard is one of the biggest excuses that we use. I don't even think we begin to realize how much we use that as an excuse. Well, it's just too hard. And we think that excuses us. Because it's too hard. That doesn't get you out of it. That just means you need to press into God deeper. If something's a little bit harder, then you press into God deeper. Don't have this attitude. Well, there's no way I can be happy with the life I have. Yeah, you can. If you make up your mind, you're going to be. You can find joy in the middle of your mess. You can find something to laugh about. You can find something to be appreciative for. See, there's one thing that always amazes me when you come right down to it. Bottom line is the answers are in here. But now listen. It's up to each one of us individually but you don't understand but they I don't have anybody to put me in the pool. You know, I barely passed English. And I'm preaching in 40 languages to 2/3 of the world. And it's not because I'm so smart or so talented. It's because I've been a pit bull in the spirit. It's because I just would not give up. And it's amazing what happens if you just won't give up. The devil wants you helpless and hopeless and saying everything is too hard, it's just too hard, it's just too hard. We read some stuff about the Israelites last night in Numbers 21:4. They always got discouraged and depressed during trials. Always. Every time things got hard, they got discouraged and they got depressed. They were led by their feelings rather than being led by the Word of God. And actually in Deuteronomy chapter 8, which was a really key chapter in the Bible for me, I can't take time now to tell you all the whys behind it, but I was just going through so many things as a young believer in ministry, and I just didn't get it because I was like, I knew God could fix it, and He just would not. Anybody been there? And then He brought me to Deuteronomy 8. He says, I've led you all this way, these 40 years in the wilderness, to humble you and to prove you, to test you, to see if you would keep my commandments or not. That you might know that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Our life is not in having all of our circumstances the way we want them. Our life is in Christ, in knowing Him. So many good lessons that we can learn from these Israelites if we'll look. Deuteronomy 30, verse 11 through 14, I'd like us to look at these. For this commandment which I command you this day is not too hard. It's not too difficult. Everybody say it's not too hard. Nor is it far off. No, you don't have to say that. See, only do what I tell you to. It's not a secret laid up in heaven that you should say, who's going to go up for me to heaven and make this happen in my life? See that? It's not a secret. Who's going to go to heaven and bring this to me that we may hear and do it? Neither is it beyond the sea that you should say, who will go over the sea for us and bring it to us? I think this is pretty amazing. It's not too hard. Stop saying it's too hard. And stop saying, well, who's going to go get it for me and bring it to me? Who's going to go over there and get it for me and bring it to me? When are they going to fix this? That we may hear and do it. But the word is very near you, in your mouth and in your mind and in your heart, so that you can do it. What enables you to do anything that you need to do in life? Knowing the word and speaking the word, especially when your circumstances stink. Instead of talking about how we feel, and you know, there's a right time to talk to people and share things and, you know, kind of vent and get things off of our chest, but we don't need to just do it over and 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 over. Exodus 13:17. And when Pharaoh let the people go, now watch this, God led them not by way of the land of the Philistines, although it was nearer. You mean, God, you could make this easier and you just won't? Well, what's that all about? I thought you loved people. I thought you were merciful and good and kind, so why don't you just get rid of this situation? I know you could if you would. Okay, let's put it back up. God led them not the easy route, for God said, lest the people change their purpose when they see war and return to Egypt. Now here was the bottom line. When they came out of Egypt, God wanted to take them into the promised land, but the promised land was occupied. And so the word possess, when the Bible says possess the land, the word possess means that you have to first dispossess the current occupants. So what that meant was they weren't just going to float into the promised land and live there floating around on a glory cloud. They had to do war with the current occupants and drive them off. And God said, you're not ready for that. See, sometimes we want things that we're going to have to really battle the devil in order to have, and we want the thing, but we don't know the first thing about battling the devil. Some people want to be out casting out devils, and they don't even have authority over a sink full of dirty dishes. Maybe some of you ought to clean your house before you worry about your ministry. Well, I want to be the worship leader in church. I think I've got a much better voice than the person that's singing, and God, that's my vision, and I don't understand why you don't at least let me in the choir and part of the worship team, and then maybe I can move up to worship leader. You can tell God what you want, and he'll bring it to you at the right time. You don't need to promote yourself. Well, what am I supposed to do in the meantime? Clean your house. Love your kids. Study the word. Be good to your neighbors. Well, I did that once. How about the woman with the issue of blood? She didn't give up. Everybody told her to leave Jesus alone, but the Bible says she pressed through. She pressed through. Mark chapter 4, Jesus got in the boat with the disciples. He said, let us cross over to the other side. He went to a quiet place in the boat, took a nap. A violent storm of hurricane proportions arose. Ah! Oh, don't you love us, Jesus? How could you be asleep? Don't you care? We're never going to get to the other side. And I love, just a few verses later, it says, and they arrived at the other side. You know, if Jesus says we're going to cross over to the other side, you will arrive on the other side. But how you make the journey is totally up to you. I didn't fall out of bed one morning and have this ministry. I thought that was how it was going to happen. I really thought after God spoke to me, you're going to go all over the world and teach the word and have a large ministry. I thought, whoa, let's go, Jesus. Lord, have mercy. I remember when I prayed one day, I remember still where I was at. Oh, God, please, please, please. I mean, I was just, you know, I wasn't really all that young when God called me to do this. I was like already in my 30s, and I didn't even start this ministry until I was 42. And so don't tell me you're too old or your time has passed you by. I don't want to hear that. Don't even bother telling me you got too many kids, because I had four. And one of them, when I started, I mean, I was in ministry 10 years before that, but I was working for other people. When God called me to start this ministry, I had a baby who actually is now the CEO of, oversees all the television and the media and all the stuff that you guys see. And I started with him on my hip. So don't tell me you can't do anything because. Let's go back to what we said last night. You make your mind up, you can do anything God tells you to do. I said, if you make your mind up, and you cannot let other people discourage you, and you cannot let your circumstances discourage you, when he says cross over to the other side, you will. I recall when I was praying and asking God, just please, God, I just want to teach just 12 times a month. If I could just teach the word 12 times a month. Because I wasn't really getting too many offers back then. And I distinctly heard the Spirit of God say, are you sure you want that? Well, of course, I was like these guys that wanted to sit one on the right hand and one on the left hand to Jesus. He said, you don't know what you're asking for. See, I didn't have any idea back then about the responsibility side of all this. My little hour of fame here, or my half hour on TV, or whatever it is such a small part of all of this. The most part of it is the part that nobody sees. I'm not on television just because I want to be a movie star. Actually, I thought it'd be funny to tell you, this year I've had two offers to be in movies and turned them both down. They wanted me to play somebody's mother. I said, no, thank you. I've already got enough spiritual kids out there. I don't need to be somebody else's mother. And I feel like I'm already all of your mothers, so. Now, you know, I'm not saying I would never do that, but the point is, I could have been in the movies. I don't want to. That's not what I'm doing this far. With all my heart, I want to see you have what Jesus died for you to have and be what he died for you to be. I want to see you have the life that Jesus died for you to have. Oh, he paid a terrible price for our freedom, and we cannot spend our life wandering around in the wilderness, going around and around the same stupid mountain. It's time to take responsibility. Stand up and be men and women of God and set our mind right and make decisions and refuse to let your mind be a garbage dump for Satan.